It is a great pleasure and honor for me to introduce Professor Ted Hannan as a keynote speaker for today. Professor Hannan is so well known for his great contributions to the subject that it would be a waste of time to give a personal introduction of his person. It is also well known, in particular, Professor Hannan was one of the major contributors on the subject of linear system scientification, which is the subject of his talk entitled The Statistical Theory of Linear Systems. Professor Hannan, please.
Thank you very much, Manfred. The thing I'm going to emphasize in the talk today is the use of linear systems as to approximate to some stochastic structure, which we view as the true but unknown and unknowable stochastic structure. To be sure, there may be no such thing in the whole notion of a stochastic process as a figment of our imaginations, but nevertheless, I will act as if there is a true structure underlying, but that it doesn't belong to the model class that we'll be using. And that view, of course, has underlined much other work in time series, particularly that of people such as Shibata and Akaiki. So it's time series analysis as approximation. And once we view time series analysis as approximation, then, of course, we have to think anew about the need for some criterion on the basis of which to choose a suitable approximant. Secondly, it's apparent that the dimension of the parameter vector will be data dependent. For example, as you get more data, it's certain that you will fit a more complicated model. As a result of these two things, in turn, there will be a complex theory. And only the beginnings of that theory exists at the moment, and I'll say something about that later. Finally, it brings to mind something that is already apparent, that is that the complex interplay between theorems and reality. For example, you might be concerned with fitting such models as I consider here in order to encode data optimally for transmission over a noiseless channel, optimally from the point of view of use of channel capacity. The signal being transmitted might be international telephone conversation. There would be no point, no hope, of course, faithfully modeling so anything so complicated as a telephone conversation, which is of the same degree of complexity, I guess, as, I don't mean complexity in your sense, as the human mind. Any theorems you you would develop in relation to that would, of course, be to a highly idealized case. Nevertheless, the theorems are needed in order to study the methods, because if the methods don't work well in relation to idealized cases, they're unlikely to work well, for example, in relation to the true case that applies. One other alternative, of course, to theorems is simulations, but they're limited in scope, although important. This rather cluttered slide starts off by describing what the underlying model I'm using is, underlying idea is, that we have data YT, which is consists of N observations, which are a linear combination of certain input, observed inputs, ZT, lagged inputs, ZT minus J, plus an additional term, and this additional term I'm taking to be stationary, which I've called zeta T, and I've expressed it here in terms of the innovation sequence epsilon T. As you can under very general circumstances, this is just a convenient normalization. And of course, since these are the innovations or linear prediction errors, they are uncorrelated, and I've called sigma their sigma slash their covariance matrix. And of course, this condition here follows from the stationarity and finite mean square, and I've imposed this condition also, where the norm could be taken to be the Euclidean norm. That's the largest singular value. In order, what we want to do is to describe, first of all, those systems in another way, and then use that to suggest a process of approximation. And for that purpose, I introduce the so-called Hankel matrix, which I've shown the ijth block here. So the ijth block is kij plus 1, where kj occurs here, and then beside it, lij plus 1, I plus j minus 1, sorry, I plus j minus 1, where the lj comes from here. A better picture, perhaps, than that is the one that appears on this transparency here, a bit more detail, showing the blocks written in. And the point of the Hankel matrix is that everything is the same down the diagonals going this way. I'll speak of K1, L1, K2, L2, and so forth as the first row of block of rows. Then this is the second block of rows, K2, L2, K3, L3, and so on, and the third block of rows, and so forth. And I'll speak of a row in a block. There'll be n rows in each block, and there are infinitely many blocks. Now, there's a construction here with which many people here will already be familiar, and I feel I'm emphasizing old things here, but since this is a keynote address, I suppose I'm allowed to do that. In order to describe the system in another way, which is very familiar to many people, but not to all of you, let's call H, so script H is the Hankel matrix. H naught is the matrix of rows forming a basis for the rows of all the rows of the Hankel matrix. The rows of H, of script H, are square summable, and therefore they lie in a well-known vector space, usually called little L2. And therefore, what we mean by linear dependence is well defined. And so we can think of finding a set of rows of script H that form a basis for all the rows of H, in terms of which all the rows of H can be expressed. Then, using a number of definitions here, which I'm not going to go into in any detail, except for this notion of choosing a basic set of rows, I'll leave it on the transparency, but I won't go through it. Using a set of definitions then, just following immediately from H naught, you can write the original process, represent the original process yt in this way. First of all, you introduce this vector, infinite vector in general, xt, which is unobservable, and xt plus 1 is axt plus l times zt plus b times epsilon t. So you've represented xt plus 1 in terms of its previous value plus the current, at time t input and the time t innovation. And then yt is just a linear transform of xt plus the innovation. And this is usually spoken of, or could be spoken of, as the general prediction error state space representation. And it's from that that we're going to begin. It's from this representation, in a sense, we're beginning, or equivalently, we're beginning, of course, from the Hankel matrix H, script H, from which all this derived. I have to introduce some other definitions. I'm calling little k of k of z just the generating function for the coefficient matrices of the innovations. So it's this function here. I'm taking z to the minus j in that definition there. And similarly, little l of z for the generating function of the coefficient matrices for the linear expression through which the inputs affect the output. The conditions actually don't quite make these analytic for z greater than or equal to 1. They make them analytic for z greater than 1 on square integrable upon the boundary of the unit circle, but other conditions on it close later will make these expressions analytic for z greater than or equal to 1. The determinant of k is not equal to 0 for z greater than 1. That's a consequence of saying that the epsilons are the innovations, but in fact other conditions on it close later will require this for z greater than or equal to 1. And that, for reasons I won't go into now, is not an additional imposition that I think is of any importance. It's a well-known theorem, which goes back a very long time, I believe, that the Hankel matrix script H, being a finite rank, is the same as saying that matrices K and L are matrices of rational functions of Z. Each element of the matrix is a ratio of polynomials in Z. And the basic idea of the approximation is to approximate to this general structure I began from by means of one whose Hankel matrix is a finite rank. And it's a natural way to think of the process of approximation. And of course, it means that we're approximating by the transfer functions by transfer functions that are rational, and that means we're back to what are usually called RMAX systems. I often think that people looking at statistical time series analysts must think they're an awfully dull lot of fellows because they never do anything but almost but talk about RMR and RMAX models. But you can see from this that they are in fact very general. The problem then is to describe all such rational transfer function matrix functions uniquely, and also to equivalently to describe all state space forms. The only arbitrary element, in fact, in the choice of H in the state space representation I wrote down here, the only arbitrary element there was the choice of H naught. Everything else was determined once I chose H naught, and therefore I get a unique description of all these rational transfer function systems. Remembering now that since it is a rational transfer function system, script H is of finite rank, then we get a unique description by choosing H naught in some canonical fashion. And one canonical way of doing it is to choose the first rows of H naught as you that you find that are linearly independent as you go down the rows of script H. And then once you've done that, adopted that rule, then everything is determined. And therefore, once you've adopted that rule, you'll get a canonical description of a rational transfer function system. I think these sort of observations, incidentally, some of the ones I'm talking about now, were first made by Jorma Rissanen. If Ruj is the jth row in the youth block, remember, according to this picture here, we've got these rows of blocks of rows, and I'm considering the say this is the third block of rows, and I'm taking the jth row, j being from one, going from 1 to n, in the youth block, in the third block, for example, then taking the if Ruj is the jth row in the youth block, then if you choose the rows this way, find the first linearly independent rows, they'll always be like this. That is, you'll take all rows up to a last one. You'll take, for the jth row, you'll take all blocks up to a last one. You won't omit some blocks and then take some later ones. And therefore, the basic set of rows are defined just by these integer gj, integer dj. So you know, you prescribe a basis by prescribing these dj. These dj are called Kronecker indices, and their sum, which is, of course, the rank of the Hankel matrix, because it's the number of rows in a basis, is called the Macmillan degree. All this is rather old stuff, as people, many people here will know. There's only one other thing I want to say, then, about this before I go on to other things. There is, just to complete the description, and I've written it on this slide here, so the DJ are the Kronecker indices. Now, given the DJ, there is a unique representation of those transfer functions K and L in the form A tilde to the minus 1 B tilde, A tilde to the minus 1 D tilde. I've used tildes because I'm going to call A and B some other things later. A tilde, B tilde, and D tilde are just matrices of polynomials in Z. Of course, I originally spoke of Z as being a function. I wrote it out as a power series in Z to the minus 1. But if it's a rational function of Z to the minus 1, of course, it's a rational function of Z. And therefore, of course, it can be written as a ratio of matrices of polynomials in many ways. But there is a unique way. And the unique way can be described in this simple via this simple diagram here. I'm representing each matrix A tilde. I've taken B tilde minus A tilde, which is easier to describe, and D tilde. Remember, A tilde is the generating function. A tilde, B tilde, and D tilde occur here. And in the diagonal, written down the diagonal, are polynomials, and the ith polynomial, the ith element, is a polynomial of degree di, where di was the ith Kronecker index, and is monic, that is, the highest power is coefficient 1 as coefficient 1. And then all these other inequalities here refer to inequalities of degrees relative to the diagonal element. So all down here, all in the column in which the diagonal element lies, the degrees are lower than the diagonal element. To the left, in the same row as the diagonal element, the degrees are less than or equal to that of the diagonal element. To the right, they're all less than. Once you impose those degree requirements, including the ones on the diagonal, then you have only one representation of K and L in terms of matrices of polynomials of this kind. And moreover, If you consider the freely varying elements in the matrices here, that's the freely varying coefficients. In other words, those other than those that are prescribed to be 0 or 1 by these degree requirements and the monic requirement, if you use those other coefficients, then you map the set of all systems for given Kronecker indices in homeomorphically into an open set in Euclidean space. And therefore, you've got coordinates, and you're in business to do all the estimation procedure. I have written down on this other transparency what the dimension of the space is, but it's something which it's written down here. But it's something which we won't be able to spend any time on now. But you can determine what the dimension of that space is, of course. There is, of course, also an Rmax form. You'll all be familiar, I guess, with the Rmax form. I should have left that previous transparency up. The Rmax form for the process is written in this fashion here. If it's a rational transfer function system, it can be written in an Rmax form. And there's a unique Rmax form corresponding to that description I just gave for the transfer functions. The Rmax form is got from those A tilde, B tilde, D tilde, according to this rule here. That is, you take A tilde and take them as functions of Z to the minus 1, and then you multiply on the left by this matrix, which is a diagonal matrix with Z to the DJ in the typical place, and then you get a unique description of the Rmax form. Well, I'm not going to go over the second part of this transparency, except to say that if you put all the systems together, if you take all systems for a given Macmillan degree, that is for a given rank of the Henkel matrix, then the set of all those systems can be reviewed as a surface in a high-dimensional space, and it is of the nature of an algebraic variety. As an example of, now for given Macmillan degree, there are various possible Kronecker indices. In fact, the Kronecker indices just determine for given Macmillan degree a partition of the integer d into n integers dj. And one particular one to choose would be the one where you say that the linearly independent rows that you first find are in fact the first d rows. And in that case, the corresponding set of systems for those particular Kronecker indices I've called ud here, and that is open and dense in md. But it isn't all of md, and md cannot be globally coordinatized, except in the case where little n, that's the output dimension, is 1. I won't say anything more about that. Now, what I want to discuss next is something which really has already been discussed, and that's approximation criteria. I've been heavily influenced by the work of Jorma Rissanen, as many of you will be aware, and I want to talk here about, just because it relates to some things I'll say later, to a recent criterion, relatively recent, that he introduced called PMDL, for prediction minimum description length, predictive minimum description length. I've written this down for the Armour case for brevity, but in fact I didn't need to do that. The brevity, nothing much was achieved, I realised, after I wrote it all down. But I'll stick to that, since I would have to put another symbol here or there into the transparency, and I don't want to do that now. So let's consider the Armour case where there are no inputs. And I'm calling y sub t the vector of all observations up to time big T. Big T I take as the, if I've got a fixed batch of data, big T is the total number of time points. In Jorma's notation, this would have been y super t, and that's a more common one, but I've used a subscript t because I wanted to prime things and so on. And of course, as we've already heard this morning, if we call PYT given theta the density function of the data where theta is the parameter vector, I should have said something else here. I'm calling the parameter vector theta, and I'm calling delta its dimension. For example, for that UD, remember that UD which is open and dense in the manifold of all systems of Macmillan degree D, that UD has dimension D into 2n plus m, ignoring the variances and covariances. Of course, the number of those does not depend on the Macmillan degree. So delta in that case for UD would be D into 2n plus m. So we have this PYT theta, which is the density function, and you can write that out, of course, in terms of the conditional densities. F theta delta is the YT plus one given YT is just the conditional density of YT plus one given the past and given, of course, the parameter vector theta. And I've separately stated the dimension, although that's inherent in theta. It's the dimension of theta. This line here really follows this one. And taking the logarithms, you get this expression here. Then the PMDL principle says to choose theta hat t at time little t so as to minimize this. In other words, choose theta hat t as the maximum likelihood estimator for a given delta up and the data and from the data up to time t. Then, so we've got theta hat t given delta. Then we choose delta hat t, the estimate of the dimension, so as to minimize this expression, where theta hat s has been inserted as the parameter value at time s. The reason why this makes sense is the following. If you were I feel ashamed to be saying this in the presence of Jorm, he knows so much more about this than I do, but if you are transmitting a signal, you see, and encoding a signal, then as long as you use this rule, the decoder would be able to decode, because at time t, he'd have decoded the data by an inductive hypothesis, and then therefore he would have computed theta hat t and delta hat t, and therefore he'd know the rule that was used to encode the next observation, and therefore he'd be able to encode to decode the next observation, and so on. So this is a valid encoding rule. If we take, now it's not easy to write down, of course, a probability law for a stochastic process. There are very few cases in which you can actually do it, because you've got to satisfy all those conditions with respect to the marginal distributions, the Kolmogorov conditions, and so on. And one case you can do it, of course, is the Gaussian case, and that tends to dominate the considerations. If we took a Gaussian case, a Gaussian armor process, and what I've done here is I've changed things. I've changed from logs to the base 2 to natural logarithms. Log means natural logarithm now. I've left out some constants, and I've multiplied by 2 over t. And then that last PMDL, modulo some, you've got to make some decisions about initial values too. Modulo those, that PMDL comes to this expression star I've written down here. And I want to explain that. First of all, sigma delta hat, sigma hat with the delta of s is, well, I've written it down at time t here. It's the estimate of the covariance matrix of the innovations got by using the data up to time t to estimate the structure, and then forming an estimate of the innovation at time s, but having used all the data to time t. So these prediction errors here epsilon hat s has used all the data to time t in the formation of it, and that's a natural. That's the natural, basically. Well, that's the estimate. What I mean by sigma hat delta of s or of t. I'm sorry here. These e's here are what are sometimes called honest prediction errors. In other words, this informing this quantity here. The data at time s plus 1, it was used only insofar as the prediction was subtracted from the true value to find the error. The predictor itself informing this error was calculated using only the data to time s, as distinct from this one here, which used the data to time t, little t. So these are the honest prediction errors that occur in this formula. And there is the PMDL formula there. And part of the of the purpose of me discussing it in this way is to emphasize later, briefly, that you could in fact calculate this in an online manner, and indeed, even for data coming in very fast, say at a fraction perhaps of a millisecond between observations, you could calculate this in a recursive fashion. And I'll discuss that briefly later. Well, I want to go on now, and the third. So, what have I said so far? I've started off by talking about time series, this part of time series analysis as approximation. I've talked about, I've described how you might coordinatize the set of all rational transfer function systems. So once you've coordinatized them and described them in terms of these Kronecker indices, for example, and the continuously varying parameters in that vector theta, given the Kronecker indices, then you're in business to do the estimation procedure. I've talked about a criterion upon the basis of which you might choose a suitable approximant. And now I'm going to talk about some asymptotic theory dealing with such a procedure, but it's going to be fragmentary theory because there's nothing more than that exists at the present moment. Now, if you're going to discuss such theory, you've got to have some conditions. And I don't want to overemphasize all the stuff on this slide. Just say a couple of things. There are only two conditions on this slide which I regard as anything other than innocuous. The first one doesn't worry me. It's this condition here, which says that the epsilon t's, Ft minus 1 is, script Ft minus 1 is just a symbol for all the past. It says the expected value of the epsilon given the past is zero. And that condition, and I've often said this, I feel I'm an awful bore because I've said it so many times, but it's obvious that that condition is equivalent to saying that the best linear predictor is the best predictor in the least square sense. So that condition is only adequate for the type of situation we're considering. Because if what do you mean by linearity? It seems to me that what you mean by linearity really is that linear predictors are good. And if that's not true, then you've got a really nonlinear system and you shouldn't be trying to model it in this way. This description I gave on the first transparency, that description on this up here, this description would hold, of course, for very nonlinear systems also. You wouldn't want to use it if the system was nonlinear, that's all. So if it's not linear, and this is what I mean by linear really, then you shouldn't be doing all I'm talking about. But these methods would still relate in some ways to that, because I can't go into that here, but these procedures would, I think, play a part in an approximation procedure of a higher kind for a nonlinear system. I won't discuss that. There is one other condition here which is not innocuous and which one always would prefer to avoid, is the condition 4.4 here, that the conditional expectation of the squares, as it were, of the epsilons, given the past, is constant. And that is not innocuous, as you will see from the talk that later will be given in this, I can't remember if it's today or tomorrow, by Professor Nerlov, who will be concerned with what are sometimes called arch models. These models are ones in which all the importance is in the variation of this conditional expectation. And they're important in economics because of theories concerning risk aversion and so on. So this is this is not innocuous, and one would like to do without it insofar as one can. And therefore, I'll try to. The only condition here I'll ever emphasize is this 4.4. And that's this condition about the conditional variances being constant. I was going to. I seem to be rushing along at a great pace. This is my habit. But I think I was going to say something about estimating the dimension of a system in the case where there is a true dimension. There is a very complete theory there, which is substantiated by myself and people who have worked with me, but it's not really in the main line of what we're talking about, what I'm talking about in this lecture, so I'll skip that and talk instead about, I'll say something about the case where there is a true dimension in relation to PMDL, because that seems to be more interesting to me. Dr. Rissen has, of course, obtained expressions which show what the minimum possible description length is, at least asymptotically. And then a question arises, you see, if you have a particular method, such as PMDL, the question arises is whether, at least asymptotically, that attains the minimum description length. I want to discuss that now. I want to discuss it, I'm afraid, in a very special case. And that's the case of an AR, and that's an autoregression, and here I've written down the autoregressive model. this is the autoregressive model here. And I've taken the output dimension as one. So I'm taking just a straight AR and the output dimension one. The output dimension being one wouldn't matter very much. You could extend this fairly easily. I believe that a Jorma Risson has told me that a Hungarian mathematician with whom he's worked, Laszlo Gerencse, has extended some of the sort of thing I've done here for the Armour case. I'm not quite sure the nature of what he's done. What I've done so far I found quite hard to do. If you go back to that expression which I gave for the PMDL that PMDL expression in the Gaussian case, I won't try to find it again. I'll get too confused. But if you go back to that expression, there was an expression for the PMDL, for the Gaussian case, and it involved these prediction errors, the honest prediction errors, and they are the essential component of that PMDL formula. In this case, delta, the dimension, is p, of course, the number of parameters here, since the 0, 1 is prescribed. And the essential calculation you've got to do is to find out how this quantity, 1 over t sigma 1 to 2, t of EPS squared, how that behaves as t increases. This is the essential component, the only hard part to discuss, in the PMDL expression. And, in fact, you can show that expression is, first of all, an expression 1 over t sigma 1 to t epsilon s squared plus sigma squared p log t over t into 1 plus little o 1, almost surely. And that's not easy to... this is for p bigger than... I'm assuming now there is a true p naught. I'm sorry, I should have said that. I'm assuming now there is a true order for the autoregression. Now, this is a theorem which doesn't relate to the thing we really want to do. But it's relevant in that if this procedure doesn't work for this case, well, you'll be disappointed, to say the least. When p is bigger than p naught, and that's the only case that's hard to discuss, actually. For p less than p naught, it's easy to find to discuss this. It's only when it's bigger than p naught that the problems arise. And when p is greater than or equal to p naught, you can prove this formula here. I found it an interesting formula. You see, if you took if you used all the data up to time t to estimate the structure, and then got the estimate, maximum likelihood estimate, if you like, of the prediction variance, then as the number of parameters increased, of course, that maximum likelihood estimator would decrease as a function of p. This one is going up as a function of p. And the remarkable thing that comes out of the whole formula is that it goes up in just the right way, as log t over t, just as with BIC. And as a consequence of this, you can also prove that, in fact, asymptotically, that minimum value for the description length is attained by PMDL in this instance, and you can also prove that p hat converges to p naught almost surely, that you'll get the right order if you minimise if you choose the dimension as I described for PMDL. That's one bit of theory. Another bit of theory which I want to discuss briefly relates to to the case where there isn't any true order. Going back to that first prescription, where we just have yt described in terms of the innovations, I'm putting another condition on, namely the kj converged sufficiently fast to zero for this to be true. It's a condition which I'm putting on just for mathematical convenience, of course, but it's not a terribly strong condition. Now, we might consider the situation where you're fitting an autoregression. I'm emphasising autoregressions here only because that's the easiest case to study. But now we're fitting an autoregression when we don't believe there is a true autoregression. We're just taking data, we're going to use a criterion of the kind of PMDL, for example, or BIC, or the complexity, to choose the autoregressive order. We're fitting a vector autoregression to the data, not believing that it's generated by an autoregression. Can we prove something about what we're doing? Well, I introduced these quantities, phi pj, which are the autoregressive constants you'd estimate if you knew the true covariance structure, if you knew the true covariances, which you don't know, but if you had those given to you by God or some eternal source, and then you use those in order to estimate this, fit an autoregression of order p, then these phi pj, you'd obtain these phi pj. The phi p hat j are what you get from the actual data using a least squares method. And now I'm going to allow p to be just a little bit smaller than t to the half. So I'm going to consider all possible values of p up to little o t over log t to the half, so that's a little bit smaller than t to the half. And the following result holds that uniformly in j up from 1 to p, and uniformly in p up to, as long as p isn't bigger than little o t over log t to the half, then the error in these phi p hats compared with the phi p's, this is to say the largest singular value of this matrix, is log t over t to the half. And this is an almost sure result again. Plus a term here, which, and this term here, and most circumstances will be smaller than that, in the sense that if you use something like PMDL or BIC, then the p value you'll choose will be such as to make this term smaller than that. So this is the basic and dominant term. And that's the best result you can get at the almost sure level. So there's a result about approximation. I should perhaps discuss briefly why you might want to do this sort of thing. You might be concerned, you see, say, to fit an autoregression, to estimate a spectrum, to locate the maximum of the spectrum. You might be concerned with a very sharp spectrum, such as occurs, say, with EEG data. And you might want to know where the maximum is, sharp in the sense that there's a relatively small number of rather sharp maxima to the spectrum. And in that case, you're going to fit the autoregression. Now, a critical thing will be to determine the order of the autoregression fitted, because it's certain that there's a narrow line to tread between having too big a bias and too big a variance. But you can prove theorems that as long as the order is chosen, say, as t to the fifth, then as order t to the fifth, then you'll get the right result. But that doesn't tell you a damn thing, because what does order t to the fifth mean? You've got to actually get the order from the data, and you might choose to get it by BIC, or some such procedure as that. Now you want to know whether BIC will choose an order which makes everything work. And these sort of considerations are the considerations you'll need to do that. To give another result, I was going to give another result, but I think that time is pressing, so I won't. I'll leave that one out. Have I? Yes. Perhaps I've got it. Well, I'll go on to that result. Manfred has encouraged me to do so. You'll be sorry to hear. this result, I'm going to call kz to the minus 1, and I've got an error there, that should be phi z to the minus j. Kz to the minus 1 exists under the conditions I imposed, that there be no zeros on the unit circle. And let me say this, that effectively, unless yt is an armor process, I'm trying to state a simple theorem here. Further details will be given in the paper that will appear in the conference proceedings. But effectively, unless it is an armor process, which isn't a very interesting case in terms of what I'm talking about now, if you chose the order of an autoregression by a procedure such as BIC, this condition here would hold, I think. It wouldn't hold for an armor. For an armor, PT will increase exactly as log T, a constant times log T eventually. But let's say that this condition is satisfied, which would be true if these kj were not going down too fast. I mean, if they're going down at a geometric rate, then pt will increase as log t, but if they're going down a bit slower than that, then pt will certainly, if chosen by an armor system, by a BIC criterion, for example, will increase faster than log t squared. Then if that is true, and also, unfortunately, if 4-4 is true, don't worry about the other conditions, which are rather minor, but 4-4 is one that is imposed here, then you get an expression here which is also of some importance in the same sort of connection as I just gave, which tells you how accurately the epsilon hat you're getting, how accurate estimates they are, as estimates they are of the true innovations. And this says that the mean square error, as it were, of the epsilon hats consists of a term which just depends on how near the covariant, the true covariant. This sigma hat pt, sub pt, is the prediction error you'd make using the best autoregression of order pt to predict the data. Best using the two autocovariances and using the two autocovariances to fit an autoregression of order PT, and then using that to predict. Then this would be the prediction, the covariance matrix of the prediction errors. This is the covariance matrix, of course, of the prediction errors using the whole infinite past. So that is something that is a sort of that tells you how badly you're going to do, even if you had perfect knowledge using an autoregression of order PT, and then you've got this extra term NPT over T times sigma, and there's 1 plus at low 1. And this this formula here is rather hard to get, but it's important in a lot of applications. So it's a second example of this, of what needs to be done in this sort of context regarding the methods as approximation methods. We found something about what the approximant does. I want to finish by talking about a subject which I think is terribly interesting and very important, and that's recursive calculation. Let me say one thing here that was said to me recently also by Terry Speed. One of the dangers of statistics, and it's a danger more, I think, for time series than other part of statistics, is that the subject will be taken over by other people. There are so many clever people in fields like acoustic speech and signal processing, in systems and control, in the earth sciences, in economics and so on. There are so many clever people there, and they quickly have become possessed of the knowledge that people like myself have, statistical time series analysts, and they have the other advantage of working, of knowing something about the real world. If we don't mind out as statistical time series analysis, our subject will be taken away from us, and that could apply, I think, to statistics also. And much of what I've been talking about here has, in fact, come from people in fields such as systems and control. And these algorithms I'm going to speak about quickly here are algorithms that have been developed by people, particularly in the acoustic speech and signal processing area. What I want to say first is that vector autoregression is a basic calculation. It's the same basic calculation in time series, in a way, as regression is in general statistics. For example, you might set out to estimate an armour model, scalar armour model, let us say, for brevity, by first of all getting an estimate, epsilon hat t, of the epsilons, by an autoregression, for example, and then doing a regression of yt on the lagged y's and the lagged epsilon hats. And that would give you estimates of the a's and the b's, if you knew P and Q in an armour model. And this calculation here is basically of the form of a vector autoregression, taking yt and epsilon hat t as the thing that you're observing. It's the first line of a vector autoregression. Of course, there's more structure there too, as other people have observed, such as Jürgen Franken. So a vector autoregression is the basic calculation. And what I'd like to say is how to do the whole darn thing. That is to, I'd like to describe, not that I really could do that, quite frankly, but you could go pretty near it, how in real time to do the whole calculation, that's to fit an RMAX model to data, choosing the order and everything, by a real-time calculation, doing a number of calculations in parallel, each of which would be of the form of a vector autoregression, and using certain algorithms that are very important, which are called lattice algorithms, which many people here will know about, such as Professor Rissanen and Dr. Rissanen and Professor Deistler, but they are very important algorithms developed by people other than myself. The algorithms can be understood in the following way. Let's think of the armour case still, and write down the data here with zeros after time t. I'm assuming we're up to little t and we've got no data after little t. Then I've written all the data lagged 1 there, lagged 2, lagged 3, lagged p. Now, one way to do the calculation is to regress this column on all these other columns. And that leads to what is called a terplets calculation, in that the matrix you're going to invert is a terplets matrix. That is, it has all elements the same down diagonals going this way. The Henkel matrix had all elements the same going diagonals going that way, but this terplets matrix has them the same going this way. And the covariance matrix you'd get by considering these vectors here would be a terplets matrix, and that lends itself to increasing p. But it doesn't lend itself to increasing t, because if you add another t value, another time point in, everything changes down here, and so the last p rows here all change. And what is more sensible is to, I don't know if sensible is the right word, but what you can do is to leave everything out from there onwards. Just leave all that out. And use only these rows here. And it's on that basis that these lattice algorithms work. And they are remarkable in that they allow you to consider all values of P up to some maximum value recursively in T. And moreover, if you only want the prediction errors themselves, and there are also some backwards prediction errors, which I can't discuss here, if you only want the prediction errors and not the autoregressive coefficients, the jargon of the subject they're called predictor coefficients, then you only have to do a number of calculations at each for each T, which is linear in P. So it's a multiple of P. So those lattice calculations are very important. To conclude, let me say that, of course, there's another thing that has to be said, and that is that you need to forget the past, of course. That is, if you were dealing, say, with the encoding of human speech, you wouldn't want to use this second speech or milliseconds of speech in encoding that. You wouldn't want to make any use of what was said 5 minutes ago. So you've got to forget the past in doing the whole business. And one way to forget the past, and I'm heavily leaning here on a relatively recent book by Leung and Soderstrom, Theory and Practice of Recursive Identification, MIT Press, 83. One way to do it is, these procedures I'm talking about are basically least squares procedures. So instead of minimizing ys minus tor primed xs, where tor is the vector of coefficients you've got to estimate, you weight that by a quantity lts, which is of this form here. Often the lambda u would be constants between 0 and 1, a constant between 0 and 1. And then, using this weighting down, all that's required, so far as the additional calculation is concerned, is about one or two multiplications extra. And you can do the whole thing with this forgetting, with one or two multiplications extra. Of course, to analyze that mathematically is very difficult. I won't say any more about that, because I haven't got time, and I apologize if I have gone over the time that was allotted to me. And in any case, I've stopped now. I shall stop now.